Hello, everybody. Well, today's topic is going to be the Golden Age of Spanish Jewry, a very important and fascinating and unusual period in medieval Jewish history. What I'd like to do in this brief lecture is to give you a quick sense of why Spain is different from most of Jewish history, either in North Africa, the Middle East, or in Europe, and then look specifically at what's different about Spanish Jewry specifically. And that'll wrap it up for today. It's not going to be a very long lecture, although if we look in detail at many of the specific individuals that I'll mention only in passing, there's a lot more to say. So first of all, it's important to understand that Spain has a triangular culture. There are three main populations, actually more than three, but three big ones that we're going to be concerned with, specifically Christians, Muslims, and Jews. This is very different from what you'll find in Europe, in which you basically have Christians and a small Jewish population, or in North Africa, where you'll have Muslims and a small Jewish population, and the same basically holds true for the Middle East, where you'll have Muslims and a small population of Jews. There are also small Christian populations. I don't want to overgeneralize this, but this is especially the most important thing about Spanish Jewish history, is that the Jews were in a situation where they, although they were never in the majority, the fact that power was divided between three major populations rather than power concentrated in one major population meant that Jews had a lot more leverage that they could use for their own advantage, which in many cases they actually did, and rose to tremendous heights in Spanish Jewish culture. Let's have a look at the quick history of Spain. So, first of all, when we enter into the first millennium of the Common Era, Spain is dominated by the Visigoths, who are Christians, not necessarily Catholics. They had a flirtation with Arian Christianity, which is a slightly different theological variant of it. And Jews were definitely present in Spain from, let's say, the second millennium on. We have archaeological evidence of their existence there. But things generally deteriorated over the first seven centuries of the Common Era, as the Visigothic kingdom became, surprisingly, more and more anti-Semitic. And in fact, many of the strongest decrees leveled against Jews, forced baptisms and so on, really come out of the Visigothic era, when life for Jews in Spain was rather uncomfortable, and increasingly so by the time you get to the early 8th century. At that point, in the year 711, which is an easy year to remember, the Muslims begin to cross into Spain from the south. You'll recall from a previous lecture that Islam spreads rapidly through the 7th century. It goes all the way across the coast of North Africa really quickly. And then in the early 8th century, it makes its way into Spain. For the Jews, who had been suffering tremendously under the Visigothic rule, the advent of the Muslims was actually viewed with a considerable amount of favor, and there's a lot of evidence to suggest that Jews actively encouraged the Muslim advance. So the Muslims essentially take over all of the Iberian Peninsula, which is today Spain and Portugal. They take over the entire region within very short order, and all of a sudden, Spain becomes Islamicized. And there is the beginning of what we will call the Golden Age of Spanish Jewry. We'll return to that. However, this is fairly short-lived within the scope of larger history, because the Christians begin to reconquer the Iberian Peninsula. This is a period known as the Reconquista, the Reconquest, and gradually they push themselves downward, driving out the Muslims, including the fairly aggressive Almohad Muslims who were responsible for driving Maimonides out of Spain, for example, around this time period. But over the next few centuries, from basically the 9th century to the 15th century, Spain gradually becomes Christian once again as the Muslims are driven out. Now, that's Muslim power is driven out. Muslim people, of course, still remain behind in Spain, and so you have this triangular culture perpetrated throughout the entire period, where you have Jews, Christians, and Muslims. There are also other populations like Berbers, but we're really going to focus on those three main nationalities or ethnicities present in Spain. Of course, it ends badly for the Jews. In 1492, the Jews are expelled from Spain. 5 years later, they are expelled from Portugal, and as you can see in this map, they end up moving all over Europe. They go throughout the Mediterranean all the way out to Israel and to Greece and places like that. Many of them go up north to Holland, the Netherlands, and a significant number go all the way over to the west. They go to the New World, and that will be obviously the subject of later lectures. But that's, in a nutshell, the very quick history of the Jews in Spain. You'll recall, first it was Visigothic, and it was very difficult for Jews. Then in 711, the Muslims come in, and it gets much better for Jews, the beginning of the Spanish Golden Age. And then within a couple of centuries, the Christians start pushing their way downward, and the Golden Age continues for a little bit, but certainly by 1200 it's over, and by 1492 the Jews are actually expelled from an all-Christian Spain, and shortly thereafter from an all-Christian Portugal. But let us turn then to, what do we mean by this Golden Age of Spanish Jewry? Basically, this is a period where Jews were so well integrated into culture and had such phenomenal access to the highest corridors of power, and participated very actively in really creating the dominant cultural motifs of the era, that it was a period of great flourishing of Jewish expression. And you have a series of figures of Jews who are truly unique in that they exemplify both political and sometimes military power, along with really phenomenal Jewish learning at the same time. This is something that was totally unique that we don't have really ever since that in Western history. You will have, obviously, Jews who are, let's say, you know, incredibly well adapted Jews to the general society. You have Jews who rise to high power, but they tend to be Jews who have largely left their Jewish backgrounds behind, like, let's say, Benjamin Disraeli, Prime Minister of England in the 19th century, who recognized his Jewish background but ultimately was a baptized Christian. And on the other hand, you'll have Jews who are, you know, phenomenal expressions of Jewish culture, Rashi and Tosafot, and we can go on, but they have very little access to political power over a larger geographic era. The Spanish Golden Age is one in which Jews had both positions simultaneously, where you had Jews who were really tremendous scholars of traditional Talmudic wisdom, for example, and at the same time they also had political, military, and general cultural power. That's something that really is special about the Spanish Golden Age. The kinds of figures that are exemplified by this period are, of course, the greatest of them is Maimonides, shown here in this statue in Cordoba. A little bit of an exception to the rule because he was driven out of Spain at a young age, and he really made his career in Tunisia and to a much larger degree in Egypt. But if we look at figures like Chasdai ibn Shaprut, very important Jewish philanthropist and scholar who ended up becoming a major Spanish diplomat, after him, the great Shmuel Hanagid, or Samuel ibn Nagrela, who was a Talmudic scholar who wrote an important commentary in the Talmud called the Mavo, and at the same time he was the military leader of Cordoba. I mean, for over a decade he ran the military of Cordoba and was essentially the grand vizier of the country as well. People like Yehuda Halevi, who were composing poetry in Arabic and in Hebrew. You know, a tremendous number of figures like this were really at the top of their game in so many different fields that they're truly Renaissance men who exemplify excellence in both the secular and the Jewish realm of thought and activity. This may be why, this really is the reason why in the 19th century, when there was a renaissance of Jewish expression, particularly in Europe and in Germany especially, and then of course feeding into Zionism, the Spanish Golden Age was viewed as an age of tremendous emulation, a period that Jews should really try to strive for again, achieving both secular power and Jewish power simultaneously. Which represented kind of a return to this ideal. It may have been exaggerated to some degree, but that we'll explore, of course, in History 156 when we look at the modern period. But that's basically the essence of what is the Spanish Golden Age. It ends badly. Of course, the Golden Age is really over for a couple of hundred years by the time you get to Isabella and Ferdinand's decree to banish the Jews from the Iberian Peninsula. And there's a long period of tremendous anguish known as the Inquisition, which resulted in the public burning of many Jews and resulted in the underground activity of many Jews who chose to practice their Judaism in secret while pretending to be believing Christians in public. And these are things that we will have to discuss towards the end of this course. But at any rate, in this very brief lecture, you've got an idea now of what was the Golden Age of Spanish Jewry, and I look forward to speaking with you more in the next lecture.